Great, and there's no crackling. Well done, you.
Thank David Bowles. He's our technical advisor.
I was the problem.
Okay. All right. I guess Libby and Toby are going to join us. Catherine, I want you to meet everybody. Catherine, we have next to you is Dr. Donna Devine, who lives in she's lives in Connecticut and New York City.
Hi.
Gail Siegel is in Jerusalem. David and Kathy Bowles are in Australia. Jane is in Atlanta, Georgia.
Hi.
And when the other two join us, they'll introduce themselves. Catherine, welcome. We're so happy to have you here.
Thank you very much. Organized.
I think all of us have been storing up questions for a long time. I think probably since season one, we
Ah!
were able
Oh, no, help me.
we were able to get a lot out of Bevan, but you're here now, and you can give us a whole new perspective on certainly the last two seasons.
Fine, yeah.
I want to start. And I'd like you to tell us a little bit about process. How does it work? You have script writers, there's you, there's Bevan. Can you tell us a little bit about how it all works?
Okay, well, last year was a little different. Do you want me to start with season four?
Yeah, because that's when you came, right? You
Yeah,
came.
I was with Susan Bauer in season three. I wrote episode, I think it might have been episode three or four, the abortion story when Sarah goes to the city, and another episode later in series three. And that was a group of that was when Bevan wasn't involved, right? So that was quite a different setup, a group of freelance writers. We were all, on top of each other's work and so on. And that was the first year when it had gone to Foxtel. And that year, that was the year I came in around July into rehearsals. There was deemed a need for a writer to be in rehearsals, and because Susan and I had talked a lot about acting, and so I became that person. So out of that, they then invited me to be script producer the following year with Bevan. Now that was a pretty unique situation because that was Bevan for series four. He was to write nine, and I was to write three, and I was to also be script producer in-house. And so that was pretty much we met. I was very, very, very impressed by him. And yeah, we just began to develop a relationship and a shorthand. And his scripts would come in, and we would discuss them, and then we would get together. My episodes were later in the series. I think episode eight was my first one, eight, nine, and then 11. And
What was
Bevan and I
eight?
would get together and
Which
plot those. What?
episode was eight?
That's a good question, isn't it? I know. It was it was because I'm in the middle of five, series five now. So it was the episode where Jack finally has enough and confronts Sir Richard, and they plan to knock him to kingdom come. Remember the fight, the big fight scene.
Oh, yes.
So do you now, I've written soap opera before, and we, have a Bible, and then it's broken down to scenes, and somebody writes dialogue. How do you write the whole episode? Does Bevan give you the storyline? Can you give us a little more
Sure. So for me, let's say obviously he's doing his own thing. No, so for Bevan and I working together, it's pretty much what you would expect. I know soap operas are a little bit different, because they're doing many more episodes a week for starters. This would be almost anyway, you almost think of this as a sort of extended mini series in some ways. So Bevan and I got together, we discussed what his ideas. Look, you know, it's his show. He has great story ideas, and obviously he's got, you know, he's got all of the storylines in his head. And but you know, very, very open to other people's suggestions. And so I think we spent the day talking about that. In what we do, I think we did. I did a dot point synopsis of all the scenes that really no one else was going to look at. It was really for me and for Bevan. And then just I launched straight into first draft. So, but again, when you say straight into first draft, that's a lot of structuring. That's a lot of, you know, you're often saying, okay, where are our first commercial breaks? Where's the second commercial break? Because that will give you the impetus. But even before you're doing that, you really, I think what you normally do when you're plotting something like this, and Bevan and I would have worked this way, is you just take the characters. What's Sarah and George's story this episode? What's Elizabeth's story? What's Carolyn doing? What's Jack doing? What's you know, Olivia and James doing? How do they go on a journey where, you know, we're fearful for them. We hope something will happen. We fear it won't, or we fear it will. So, yeah, that's the process. And then I would deliver the first draft, and still do. And usually, right now it's just Bevan, myself, and Chris Martin Jones, the producer, and we go over that. And we're usually plotting in blocks. So a block is episode 1 and 2, 3 and 4, and so on. And so often, for instance, say if I was doing episode 8, but Bevan hadn't yet written episode 7 last year, obviously there'd be stuff in my episode 8 that needed adjusting once he delivered his first draft. So it's very much a to and fro process. And of course, then you're going on to the third draft and then many, many amendments as the script continues through the process.
Are you on set? Is it like film, or where there are constant changes?
Yes, and it's probably in television. It's probably more likely that the writer is nearby. In the States, of course, you have showrunners where the writers are really, you know, totally producing. So I suppose my job is as close as we get to that in Australia. Chris Martin Jones is executive producer, you know, is producing the directors and budgets and all of that. I don't do that stuff. But the set is downstairs. So my office, there's my office, there's next door to me is the art department. And so it's a great thrill if I'm writing scenes to rush in and say, could we have a little toy that would make baby Georgie smile when Elizabeth says goodbye so they don't have to talk? And, you know, the wonderful Fiona will say, yes, I'll do I'll make a little finger puppet or something, you know. So the art department's there. The studio is downstairs. So, and the rehearsal rooms are just across a very large room, an office. So, depending on the director, I will be in rehearsal all the time. Some directors are happy, they'd like me there right from the beginning. Otherwise, I'm on kind of emergency call, if you like. So if their actors are rehearsing, they hit a stumbling block, they're not sure, I'll dash over. So I always have to keep those scenes in my head. I try to memorize those scenes so I can run into the rehearsal and know, you know, and pick up pretty quickly what they're up to. Does that answer your question?
I think does anybody have any other questions about? I think you've given us a pretty good idea, Donna.
Yeah, I do.
Okay, no, Jane. Sorry, Jane.
As a follow-up, what is a script producer? Your list is producer.
So I'm responsible for getting the scripts out. So making sure, say in series 5, that the other writers that we're plotting together. In my case, sometimes a script producer would be also creating the story. you know, the whole series. I'm not doing that because I've already worked with Bevan and I have an idea of where very strong idea of where he wants to go with each episode. He and I together alone have plotted those things out. So then I'm conveying that to the writers. I'm on call to the writers as they start to develop their synopses, as they're uncertain about, you know, where characters have gone in previous series, and then I'm also trying, if they're new to the show, which that they can be, trying to impart the tone that Bevan wants and that the series requires. Then as we get closer, as we get through first draft, second draft, in the meetings with the writers and the executive producers from the network and from Foxtel, helping or just coordinating those meetings, making sure that the writers go away feeling comfortable, knowing where they need to go next. Then once the director comes, then there's a director's meeting. I'm part of that. I will have met and talked to the director about the episode, any challenges they have, any ideas they have to make, you know, that we can facilitate, and continuing to produce a script through the read through with the actors around a big table, actors, publicity, representatives of the networks, all those people, and the read through. Now, those of you who are dramatists know, often, you know, it's not until the words are in the air that you suddenly go, oh, I've overwritten that, or that doesn't make sense. So, and so then, of course, we'll have a big meeting again with the writer and myself, and we'll look again at what we can do. And so then probably as we go into production, there might be, you know, another 10 set of amendments over time, not of every page, but of various scenes in the script. And I'm making sure that that they go out on time, and yeah, so that's kind of the journey.
Yeah, because when I was looking through the credits, there's the writer, the script producer, the script consultant, the script assistant.
Well, the script assistant is probably my assistant, who's wonderful, and Terrence McCarthy, or maybe he's script coordinator. So he's the one who makes sure that all the right editions of everything are out, that everyone has the right pages, the right amendments, because you go through all different colours, they call, you know, different, like you go through the blue amendments, then the green, then the yellow, then the pink, and so on and so on, then the golden rod, and, you know, you're starting to dig through that rainbow. And so he's another genius because he remembers everything. He's been on the series since series one.
Wow. So
you can say to him, does so-and-so have a whatever? And he'll go, oh, yes, yes, they have one of those. Or, yes, he's got a much better memory than I have.
Well,
I couldn't do this without...
The obsessive fans on the fan club page have found a few inconsistencies here and there. So we're going to blame it all on Terrence.
No, we do them deliberately just to keep people on their toes.
Catherine, Bevan tells me that he just finished episode 10. We know that you don't go into production till February. When he says he's done with episode 10, exactly what does he mean? And it goes from him next to you? What's the
actual process?
Yeah.
So, I'd have to look at my schedule here, but... He's written episode 10 and what we would call a first draft, which for Bevan, you know, is probably the equivalent of a fourth draft because he's such a good writer. But it's called a first draft. So we will meet with the other writer in the block who's written now episode 9, and we'll get together and we'll massage those two, and they will go away and rewrite them, and come back with another draft in a couple of weeks. And always, you know, we'll be keeping an eye on how the show is panning out in the earlier episodes as well. So that really won't shoot until, and that will continue on. It sounds like there's a lot of time, but suddenly.
Hello. Hi.
Sorry.
Hi, Libby. So, Libby?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, so we're in, we've started the conversation already. Tell Catherine where you are.
I'm in Chicago.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm going to try to turn the video on. There we go. Okay, let me get some light here. And here we are. Sorry.
Libby, we're talking about process. Catherine is telling us how it goes, where Bevan starts, and how it gets down, filters down. So I'm sure you'll catch up.
Okay.
Go ahead, Catherine.
Back to Bevan's episode. So, last year, there came a point where Bevan just said at times, I trust you, you do what you need to do now, to get it up to speed. Other script, but I'm always on the phone to him and checking that the change, making him aware of any changes that I have to make as we go along. Yeah, but but when he says I've done episode 10, it really means what we would say breaking the back of that story and leading us on, putting us in a really good place. I have no doubt for episodes 11 and 12 of series 5, which we are yet to plot. We're going to be doing that the week after next.
Before I turn it on to somebody else, I noticed in the credit roll that there are seem to be a lot of women, more women than I'm used to seeing on a lot of series here in the United States, particularly women directors. Is there kind of a, I don't want to say feminine feel, but do you feel that because there's so much, so many women with so much input, that it's had an impact on the story?
Look, to start with the directors, I asked about this the other day. We were talking about how there's a fairly good gender balance, and the same is not always said of television. Chris Martin Jones, who is a wonderful producer, and that's his role, is to select the directors. He said he really doesn't consider gender. So we just happen to have a whole bunch of very good. We get the best directors possible, and they been actually we had for season 4. Yeah, we had three women, three men, I think. Is that right? Yeah. 50-50.
Excellent. Okay, Donna. For those of you who don't know, Donna is one of she's a very, very active participant in our page, and her area of expertise, she's a professor of Middle Eastern studies. So she's interested in all aspects, but she's really our expert when it comes to the portrayal of the Jewish experience on the series. And we've talked a lot about the authenticity of the portrayal. And I know Donna has a lot of insight and a lot of questions. So Donna, the floor is yours.
When, to be fair about the Jewish experience, no one has real insight or total insight on the Jewish experience, but I have a simple question and more complex question. So the simple question for many of us watching the birth of Sarah's son is why there was no circumcision or mention of a circumcision, a brit. And particularly since Sarah seemed to be conscious before her child was out of the isolette, she seemed to be conscious that there was a legacy that would be imposed on him by the Blies. And certainly as a Jewish male, there is an expected legacy. So that's the simple question. I'll wait to ask the more complex one.
Okay, it becomes very interesting in drama that I understand you can tie that into her, her wanting the child to be Nordman or, with all of the business about the birth certificate. I think that probably would never have made it. If we had that focus, it probably wouldn't have made it into the through the edit. That's I think. So we end with her getting the baby and the baby being the most gorgeous thing, and then we jump 2 weeks. So what happened in that 2 weeks? That's what we might find out.
Okay. The next question is, you've uncovered and drawn into the drama some incredibly sometimes esoteric customs, the breaking of the plates. I have to say that I've seen that once in my life. Actually, and I thought the mothers-in-law wanted to break the plates over their each other's heads as a sign of anger. But things like that, and then a text that Sarah will, and some of us have had to listen several times to get the Hebrew, to know where the prayer is coming from. Whereas in the first couple of seasons, there's a focus on things that are much more familiar, the Kaddish, Yom Kippur, even the mikvah, but she's in one of the episodes repeating a prayer that you say in a prayer for remembering your lost ones, or not the Kaddish, a much more esoteric one, or some of the other things that the prayer for health for her baby. Where do you get that? How do you decide that that's going to have dramatic appeal?
I think that, you know, it has dramatic appeal because, you know, she's Jewish and she has, and it separates her from the Blighs. I mean, that's the drama of it as much as anything, and George as well separates them. I'll use the plates as an example. I think Bevan wrote the plates, so I don't know where he got it from. So then there came this big discussion, which I can talk about now. So I think I have Temple Emmanuel here, that is a synagogue in Sydney. A friend of mine is a rabbi there, and I exploit his name and get through to a very nice man who answers my questions for me. And right, probably two blocks from me is the Jewish Museum. So she's also very good. The woman there is also very good. And we have a guy who helps Marta with the translations and so on. And he gives some advice. And you're right. There's three different versions of everything. Yes, we know. You know, there's always that.
More than three.
More than three. 300. So with those plates. So I rang my synagogue. I'm not Jewish, and he went, oh really, oh I don't think, oh let me ask someone, oh it's a thing with mothers and mother-in-laws and they get together. Now I had written the Mourner's Kaddish episode in series 3, and I thought I had cleverly, you know, got around her saying the Kaddish, even though she wouldn't, but by saying, you know, we've had an unconventional marriage and therefore
No, that was wonderful.
She's good. No, I was really proud of that little kind of sleight of hand.
That is also, the best episode.
Oh, thank you. And I was very proud of Chris Martin Jones. I remember because in a meeting I remember saying to him, because someone previously had got a minion mixed up, and it doesn't matter, they hadn't sort of known the numbers or something. I said to Chris, it needs 10 men. Now, you know how expensive television production is, you know. And I said, I wasn't a script producer then, just a writer. I said, could we have 10 men? And he said, yes, of course we can. And I never forget that, because I just thought, oh, I love this show. You know, you can. So we were able to do that. So with the plates, again, it was a little bit unconventional that Sarah would bring it. And I remember the art department kept coming in and saying, I've done my research. It's not right. They wouldn't have them. And, you know, and we're looking up on the internet and, you know, this isn't, it's not going to happen. And so, but in the end, we all agreed that it was too beautiful to lose. So that's that sort of thinking. Does that help you?
Yes. Yes.
You know, I think that there may have been a few moments in some of the earlier series where Sarah was a bit Sephardic and not Ashkenazi, but I think maybe.
But her Hebrew is getting better. It's getting better.
About the plates, just as an aside, because it's done, it's actually still done very much today, usually among Hasidim, and it's called Tanaim, and it is done by the mothers-in-law, and it's done before the ceremony. The men are all in a room, and the women are, you know, they're separate, and the marriage contract is brought both to the groom and to the bride. And after the groom signs the ketubah, the marriage contract, that is in fact when the mothers-in-law break the plate. Now, there are several reasons they do that, but the easiest answer about that is the breaking of the plate is kind of like the breaking of the glass. And there are several reasons that you do that, but it is about the fragility of life. And in a lot of Hasidic families that I know, the plates are taken and the pieces are turned into pins, and you will find the proud mothers-in-law wearing them. But even though it was done in an unconventional way, that Sarah should bring Craig, you know, Jack the plates, it was so, so beautiful. It reinforced their relationship as close friends and really showed how much she wanted to express her love and respect. And I found it to be, while not 100% authentic, quite beautiful. And all my religious friends who've seen it were quite taken with it as well.
Oh, that's good. As long as they don't stop watching and start discussing whether we were accurate or not, that would be terrible and miss the rest of the story. But, you know, it's, you know, I mean, and that's the challenge that we all face in television, which is making sure that in the great rush, because once it's like a steam train, once the director starts and then you've got, you know, a set time, and from then on, you're on the roll. They're shooting, they're away, and time is important, and scenes can be dropped, and all of those things. So you really always have to keep an eye on the gems, I suppose, the things that under no circumstances, well, it'd be too strong to say that, but that you really do want to hold on to, and that, for instance, would be one of those scenes. It's more is the enemy, then, you know, we are all a good team. We all work together for exactly the same end. And time is often the enemy, time and the weather.
Catherine, Libby, I want you to jump in. I just want to tell you, and for the people here who don't know, Libby is a very accomplished writer in her own right. And I just finished reading the first one of her books. I have taken four of them out of the library, in spite of the fact that I'm not a real mystery person. Her books are quite wonderful. Libby, jump right in.
Okay. Well, Catherine, it's a pleasure to meet you. My first question is, what surprised you most about a character's development over the course of the series? What did you not expect that just happened because it was natural and right?
Yes, you know that feeling when you're writing, don't you? When you absolutely have, you know, for as much as we can structure 55 scenes of a television episode and we say in the room and we say in our synopsis we know what's going to happen, then there's the next point where you start to write and the characters hopefully have free will and they start to do things. For for me, I suppose, right from the very first time I worked on the show, and I think that's, you know, that was in that series three, I'm calling it the abortion scene when Sarah goes to the city. I think it must have been episode four. The savagery of Aunt Peg, the absolute fury, blind, white-hot fury and personal fury of Aunt Peg. I remember going, you know, that moment, and I know you know it as a writer, where you start to go, oh, I can't do that, I mustn't. And then if you don't, the character will never, you know, the character will never forgive you, you know? So I do recall that. I have had a lot of moments as a writer, and please, let's all remember it's Bevan's show, right? As a writer, I'm writing Bevan's story, and he's generous enough, and I'm smart enough to make it feel like it's my own, right? But it's his. I've had moments I've really enjoyed with Sir Richard, you know, he's got stuck in, you know, where I think the scene was, he walks down the stairs with Douglas, and my uncle was a prisoner of war, and that moment when he turns around, and I, again, one of those moments you go, oh no, don't do that, don't say that, God, you're going to hurt so many people if you say that, you know, and when he talks about, oh yeah, the men who couldn't, you know, haven't survived the war, well, it's 8 years on or whatever it is, I think I got the years wrong and someone had to help me, 8 years on, and boo-hoo-hoo, you know, ghetto, you know, that kind of thing. All writing is finding your own dark place, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're doing. You're finding your own prejudices, your own racism, your own capacity for greed and envy and love, hopefully.
One of the characters, I think the one that surprised me the most, and I and I really wonder where you're going to take her in season five, is Libby. She's just... she did things in season four that I would never have thought her capable of doing. An understanding, a maturity, an awareness of the strange circumstances she was in, but the love that was underwriting it for both her, James and James's happiness. I thought as a character, she was just marvelous this season.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, Bevan had a very clear idea of where she was going. And obviously... so Darianne won, and that kind of journey, what we, I think we intended, was the journey towards a sense of internal strength, that really didn't come until, in my mind, and this was a big discussion, it came at that moment towards, I think in episode 11, which was mine, or, no, it was Bevan's, it must have been 12, where she says, could I be held, please, in the hotel room, after all of the brouhaha.
Right.
And there was a big discussion around this. And I said, that is a sign of great strength. That's actually her final point, where you can ask, you're vulnerable, you're strong enough to be vulnerable, I suppose. Absolutely. Does that make sense?
Yeah. No, I have to tell you that her scenes with James were the only things that brought tears to my eyes this season.
Right. Yeah, because, tell me why?
I think because it was so, she was handling her sorrow with such dignity and such warmth, and her whole life was falling apart, and yet she had something love, she had a generous spirit. And she was still concerned with James and his happiness, as sad as she was.
Yes, yeah. I think that was certainly Bevan's take. I think I was really glad that she did have that moment where she could run out of the house and run into the woods. I thought that was beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, and I think we've all done that kind of thing where you want to just bash. I mean, I think I probably wrote she bashes her head against a tree, but it would have been a bit too much. But, you know, you all feel like.
What happened to her in season five? Can you give us any hints?
No, of course. I would be. Someone would take me out into the woods and bash my head into a tree. And it would
well,
be
I the, something. I know something. The, something
hey, who would do that?
I know something extraordinary is going to happen because she's just a terrific character.
Yeah, no, she is. She's gorgeous, and yeah, I mean, I don't know if this is worth sharing, but just going back to the process that we started on, and just while my head's in that scene, if you recall that scene, it was with Olivia. She and Henry, who's been an absolute bastard, you know, realizes how he's been. They go to look for James, right? He's been dreadful at the party, and they end up in that hotel room. And now an example of I got called across to the hotel, to the rehearsal room, and when Tim Draxel felt that he needed more, after Olivia asks that question, can I be held? And he felt he needed more, and of course, you know, I always argue for the writing, and I'm saying, no, you've got enough, you don't need more. But then he made a very good case that he just needed more to express his love for James in that scene, if it was just one line or two lines. So again, that's my role, is to quickly come up with something that I think will serve that, you know.
That was really
where we began.
Sorry. I just had one other question. How much not improvisation, but how much change goes on between the script and what the actors want to do once they've taken the character under their into their psyche?
Look, the actors and the director, the directors really encourage the actors to work within the text, to find within the text. So there has to be a fairly good case made, and it will often be a phone call from location, change one word to me. But I would certainly, none of that can really does happen without a good reason. And often an actor, you know, could say, no, I have to change. And then you explain, they go, oh, okay, now I get it. Or they'll ring back in 20 minutes off the set and go, oh, you're right. I forget what I, you know. So, but yeah, no, not very much at all. I have worked on a show like that where there was a lot of improvisation many years ago, and so much story that disappeared. I can't even begin to tell you, but it made me want to give up writing forever. So,
Catherine, I want to say that first of all, the story of Olivia and James, I think we were all hooked on it from the very beginning, and it's so magnificent to see how both of them have grown as actors. They're presented with new challenges every episode, and you know, they're kind of the younger ones, and you know, people like Noni and, you know, Frankie and Brett, you know, they're seasoned actors, and we expect them to deliver great performances. But the two of them have been so just outstanding, and we really love them. Now, I had been saying for a long time that I missed Harry, and that they should bring him back. Why did they, you know, why was that storyline ended? And I, for one, was delighted when he reappeared, because I thought, you know, he would certainly add something to the story. But I think that Dominic Albarn is just a wonderful, wonderful actor, playing a, you know, a character that's evolving in a world that he doesn't really know and feels that he doesn't belong in. And I think he's just been extraordinary. And I, for one, can't wait to see, you know, how that evolves. I'm going to let somebody else ask, but I want to ask you one thing. Just shifting gears, you know, the rape scene must have been incredibly, incredibly difficult to write. I know we have spoken to Sarah about what it was like to play it, but how is a scene like that written?
Yeah, now I'm trying to think who wrote that. That was series three, wasn't it?
Yes.
I'm pretty sure it wasn't me, although I might have had some rewriting on that scene. Look, you know, you're right. As a writer, you are required to write, or you want to write, as I said before, from your own darkness. And there is a part of what I would say, you know, occasionally I teach, not very often, but, you know, you need, as I said before, I would want to find the part of me that could rape someone. There must be a part of me that could do that damage, or could lie to myself and think I was doing something else. I mean, I'll give you a horrible example, and I don't want to give you nightmares, but years ago I wrote for a TV series called GP, which was rather terrific because you didn't have to include all the regular actors, so you could kind of write a play of the week. And the regular actors kind of walk past in the background, but, you know, you could create this one-hour drama. You know, British, you have those sort of one-hour dramas. Anyway, I wrote an episode about a father who got a girl pregnant, who got his daughter, you know, incest story, daughter pregnant, and then got a phone call sometime later saying, we're wanting to write a story, a drama from about a pedophile from the pedophile's point of view.
Oh, wow.
So, of course, I said, oh, thanks for, and we thought of you was the other, you know. Yes, okay, thank you very much. And so just two things. I mean, that's a show you're not interested in, but just in terms of being a writer, I got someone in who treats pedophiles, and we sat and talked, and so I read their diaries. I wanted to know in their head how they justify everything. And then and I'm not doing anything that any other writer wouldn't do, that Bevan wouldn't do. You know, I mean, it's a normal writer's process. I remember there was an observer in the room, a young woman who wanted to get into television, and she kept sighing and going, oh, no, oh, oh, as the psychiatrist was talking. And I had to ask her to leave because the psychiatrist, of course, was clamming up and not wanting to, you know, divulge what I needed to know. So does that answer the question?
Yeah. It does. Over in the corner is our David and Kathy Bowles. David, among other things, well, his biggest role is that he's our technical person, and he comes through for us to record and to, you know, put it up on YouTube and to really get the masses to see it. But and his mother Kathy is right next to him, and they're Australian, and I'm curious, you know, you're talking to Americans here, and it is an Australian drama, and they've been watching, Kathy's been watching from the beginning, and she's also a very avid viewer of all kinds of television. So Kathy, you know, share with us a little bit of your insight, and you've got Catherine here to answer whatever has been on your mind for the last 4 years.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. We turn this off most of the time because of feedback, because we're recording. Okay. You've really opened a can of worms there, Susan, because, as you know, I was not happy with season three. It quite traumatized me. And probably
tell us why. Why?
It seemed as though, and I know that... Arian Wen, I think, has said this in one of her in her chat, I think, or somewhere that somewhere. That feedback that she was hoping that something nice would happen to her character next season. So many things went wrong. When I watch programs, I identify with the characters. I feel it. I hate them, or I love them, or I like them. And when too many things are too traumatic, I often say, that's enough. Quite every now and then I say, that's it, I'm not watching that anymore. When I found Bevan was coming back, I thought, there's a ray of hope. We're going to have, it's going to be, because I don't know why, but I've, you know, it's, I'm still recovering from season three, because it was a really big thing for me until then. And just all those things. I've particularly felt what happened to Carolyn too. That was really, I thought, no, not our Carolyn. That can't happen to her. She's a real person, you know. And so those sort of things. Yeah, so I was happy. And the question I was going to ask is a bit related to that. You were talking about tone before. We've been talking about this. We think that it's slowed down. The pace has slowed back down to the way it was before. And I think that's true. I was going to ask you about, I can imagine some of the things. How do you make the tone change to the way you want it to be? For example, you've got something that's really fast-paced and dramatic and melodramatic, and then you have something where it's much more leisurely, the way the show has always been until season three, unless I'm remembering wrongly.
Right, so it is interesting, just on the, you know, say the question of, just before get to tone, of what happened to Carolyn. It was traumatic and it was terrible, and in real life it would take an awful long time to work through. In the world of television, I think we are aware of exactly what you're saying and your kind of response, which is we can't expect the viewer to go through too much of that pain. That's what you mean, isn't it? Would I be right? Yeah, sorry, I can't quite see you. So, yeah, so, there you are. Great, yes, I can see you now. Yeah, so I think, and that, you know, so we have to always strike that balance, I suppose. The journey for Olivia, I think, is she does in series four go through, yeah, a lot of ups and downs, but that is the nature of drama. That's how characters revealed, isn't it? So now back to tone. I'm probably not very good at really recognizing the tone of series four was very much a strong melodrama, obviously with Regina pushing that story through, and that's deliberate. It was it's sort of the Douglas Sirk kind of influence on Bevan's writing, and a lot of the films of the 1953-54 that period were of that nature, of that tone. So there is a decision, probably each series, to follow a particular tone, I guess. And we don't think of, it's not at the forefront of your mind, because story is at the forefront of your mind. But as as music comes in, or just ways of editing the story, again, you might touch back on that and go, hang on, is that the tone of our show now? I don't know if I've really answered your question, have I?
Maybe I should have said, can you hear me? Should have said pace. I should have said pace, perhaps, because pace was back to more like it was before, I think, in season four.
In series four?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, well, then there we are.
Yeah, I think that's what I should have said. But basically that you're one disaster after another sort of thing.
It's not one disaster. Probably there was more emotional tension running through series four because of that kind of strong drive of Regina. I think they're very different. Different script producer, different writers, and I think that happens in, you know, a lot of shows. Yeah. But I'm sorry if series three was so. I'm sorry that you felt that, and I hope that you will stay with the show.
Regina is so awful. You know, you were talking about, you know, having to draw, you know, imagine yourself, you know, as the character so that you, in order to write for them, please share with us what on earth about yourself could you get in touch with that, allowed you to have this.
And get me started. Wouldn't we all like to scare the hell out of people and just by walking into a room? You know, I mean, no, she's very disturbed. So of course, but what fun to write. Yep.
Jane?
Yeah.
You share so many opinions and so many insights. When Catherine is not here, this is your big chance. You know, she spent a good amount of time with us. Let's zero in on one more thing that you've been dying to know.
Oh God, I had so many questions when we chatted with the stars. I thought, oh God, can I think of a question with you? I had this tremendous list.
Oh, go for it.
Two things. Two lines. Did you write the actual lines after George's wedding when Elizabeth says, you do well to think of your wife as an obsessive 15-year-old? Did you come up with that? We love that.
I love it too. That was Susan Bauer in the plotting meeting. I believe I stole it immediately and put it into my script.
Oh, yeah.
I don't always remember who I stole things from, but I do remember her. I remember her saying that, and I thought it was perfect.
Yeah.
And obviously, Susan, who worked with Bevan on All Saints, as you know, and you know, and is a wonderful script producer, I believe she probably had someone else in mind, at the, you know, when she's someone she knows, you know. Yes, we are like, you know, little scavengers. What if people say something, you know, we'll grab it in a plotting session. We often have someone taking notes verbatim, so that you can look back and go, oh, okay, you know, I came. Often you come out with a line, you know, and you're talking about a character, but if there's someone taking notes, then you can go back and grab it. Yep.
Okay.
Keep going.
And did you think of the string quartet?
I did.
Oh, good for you. Loved it.
Picking something I did. I did. And that was a surprise, again, when writing. You know, it's like when Bevan wrote Elizabeth talking to Sir Richard after the Prime Minister's dinner. When he wrote the first draft, he had no idea that she was going to pick up a nine. You know, so, again, that's a perfect example of, I always say, you know, writers need the quiet moment. If you write a scene, you know, like if you write a synopsis to death, then you could easily blow that moment because you're already bored by it, you know, by the time you come to write it. So, so he had no idea and she just picked up a knife. And again, probably he had that little break in his mind and went, oh, my God, is this too much? Could it be too much? Well, the answer to that's always no. You know, let's put it down and see what happens, you know. So, I mean, there's a perfect example. Yes, I did do the string quartet, and I was quite proud of that. Thank you. But I didn't know that they'd find the money to do it, I have to say. I think at one point, you know, but, you know, you're always looking at budget, and I was very pleased that they found the money.
It must have been great fun for Noni and Mark to work together like that, because they're such wonderful actors. And to have that kind of material must have been fabulous.
Oh, I hope so. Yeah. I hope so. Yes, I think that, yeah, they. I think Mark laps that up very nicely. And Noni, I mean, they are all our pleasure to work with. Noni's wonderful. So you had some more questions, I think, and we interrupted.
Were there other things that you didn't get to, that you wrote, that you didn't get to put in, maybe because of budget constraints?
Oh, gosh, you know, you forget about those, don't you, really? You know, I didn't think there were too many. I mean, there was a time, you know, I don't want to spoil things too much, but, you know, like you know, diving into that cool pond, the two boys, in the middle of winter, you know. Uh-huh. I mean, that was a big challenge. And I was certainly on hold to write an alternative. Which I absolutely couldn't think of to save my life that look as gorgeous as that would look, you know, or even Harry lying in the water, you know, and then turning over. I mean, it was freezing cold. And but anyway, I don't want to spoil the magic of all of that. But look, I can't look, I'm sure there are always scenes that you lose, you know, driving scenes, you know, that you'd like to have. I think I had a long scene with George and Olivia driving along, and I'm talking about second or third draft. Olivia was talking about growing up in London during the war and how the women, it was towards the end of series 12, when they were speeding off to Sydney to find Jane, and how the women in London had always felt so the women in the country, you know, during the war, they'd felt useful, all had to go back to being wives again, and how she wanted to feel useful. And it was just a scene, it was very lovely, but it really wasn't progressing the drama. And I think I saved the dialogue of that for her to say at a party or something in the background. So it didn't go to waste, you know, like when you're making a dress, you know, there's a bit of fabric left over and I grabbed it back again. But, you know, often you talk to novelists about this process that we as screenwriters go through and, you know, because that's how I want to write for television. And Libby, I won't include you in this, but, you know, they can be appalled because they go, oh, my God, all these people have a say, all these, you're still changing things, you know, after the third draft and then there's more amendments and more. How do you put up with all this interference? Well, of course, we choose that because we want that give and take process, you know.
Actually, my background is in film.
There you go. Well,
before I started to write novels, and one of the reasons I switched was because film was too collaborative.
That's right.
And when I had an idea, once in a while, I would actually have an idea and I wanted my idea. And
yeah, now, that's right.
Of course, I wish I had more people to help me through.
Yeah, well, that's right. Yeah, I know. You can't never have it both ways. I know, it's a shame.
Now, do you have a writer's room? Is there a writer's room for the series or is it just you and Bevan?
No, well, it was just me and Bevan last time, and now we have, for series 5, we have some writers, and, our writer's room would be the writers on the block, so of episode 1 and 2, which happens to me and Bevan and myself, and then who's ever on the block, 3 and 4, 4 and 5, so, and me, yep. And I will have spoken to Bevan, you know, in the lead up, and we will have talked about what we're going to talk about in that room. And then we would meet for a couple of days initially and then meet again and again and again and again. Yeah. But the concept of the writer's room I think it's more relevant in comedy in the United States. You know, right. Those big, the big sitcoms where a lot of, where writers are often responsible for one character. And also when the American model, which is very attractive, and I've you know, sat in on these things, but where all the writers are on set, all the writers are in studio. And so they may all get together and talk about one script and throw ideas around. But generally, what we will do is get together, you know, Bevan and I were together for a week or two before we began. So that's our little writer's room, yeah.
So you have an arc for the entire season before you actually start writing each episode, correct?
Correct. And when you say you, it's really Bevan has the arc and I interpret it and throw it around and feed it back to him. But it's Bevan has that very strong concept of where it's all going. That is not my this style of drama isn't necessarily my style, and I just admire what he does so much. It's you know, he has a degree in pure dramatics, you know.
On that note, I want to ask, you know, Bevan, we all just love him, all 1500 of us in our group, we just love him. As a writer, you know, myself, I know why I'm drawn to him, but what is it about him that makes everything that he puts his hand to so spectacular. He's able to capture, I've seen a few other things. I actually binge watched Packed to the Rafters. And when I mentioned it to him, he said that was a commercial success, meaning, you know, I don't know that it was, you know, what he, that it was his perhaps favorite thing to do. What is it about him that is so special?
I think he is, you know, because I had to make, I, you know, we met for coffee and I'd never met him before. And so I had to make it, you know, I made the decision to work with him. And what I really got was that he is a writer's writer. He's, he is vulnerable. He's compassionate. Which means then that you also have an understanding of what an audience requires. I mean, there is that. He's got a very, very strong, I won't say photographic memory, but a really strong base in 19th century literature, the great 19th century novels. And he's got this mathematical brain as well, which makes him great at structuring. But I would say ultimately, he is as vulnerable and as uncertain, despite his success, as all writers are and in fact should be. Yep. And so when he delivers episode 10, actually that reminds me, I feel bad because I haven't read it yet, but he'll be waiting to know what I thought of it, whether because he's got the vulnerability of a writer. So he's never lost that. And he's just, he's got a great imagination.
Catherine, he told me that working with you was the best professional relationship that he's had. He just adores you and just loves working with you. So,
pretty mutual. I think it's pretty mutual, and we had a few laughs about that along the way, because I think the first day we sat in a room together on episode 8 of series 4. That was the, I remember, and I said, we're looking at the whiteboard, and because I like working at a whiteboard. He's smart enough just to have it all in his head. And I said, Olivia needs something in here. No, she doesn't. He said, no. This is just a small episode for Olivia. And I don't think he'd mind me telling this, because everything else was perfect and brilliant. And I said, I think she might. No, she doesn't. That's not the nature of the show. This is the first day we'd worked together. And I just said, I'll just write it myself anyway, because I'm writing the episode. And there was a little moment. And he argued against me and then came back and then said, do you see what I do? I often argue for something for a really long time, and then I change my mind and I come back again. And I just admired what that is. Something I really admire about him: his self-awareness is quite wonderful. Because all these meetings, I hope I've described as much as everyone wants to be on track. It's very easy to say, like the plates thing, if someone says, "Oh, they people don't do that." Yeah, let's cut it, right? Really easy when you're trying to, you've got the time. So. We all go into these things feel shaky and vulnerable, and I think Bevan's no exception. Yeah. The other thing, when I first went into a meeting with in the role of script producer, and Bevan said very kindly, "I'm not going to say anything. I'm just going to sit there because I really want you to feel ownership of this series 4, and I want you to." And, he meant it, and he really did. And we got into the meeting, and Bevan started talking. We'd only been together, hadn't been together very much. And afterwards I came out and I just looked at him, and he says, "Yeah, I did, didn't I? I didn't do what I said, did I?" And I said, "No." And we had such a laugh about it, and we still do. So he doesn't take himself too seriously. He's self-aware. He's extremely passionate. And he's passionate about his work when he knows he's right. And that was what really attracted me, that he wasn't going to have any he was going to stand up for his work and be strong for what he believed in for those characters in series four.
Susan Bauer brought you in, though, right? Susan Bauer is the one that brought you in originally.
Yeah, I think she called my agency to see if anyone wanted to do any scripts for A Place to Call Home. And I had just come off two very big movies that were controversial and involved a lot of legal business, and one involved criminal danger. And the idea of doing something that was made up, I just went, yes. I said, you mean this is, I'm not going to have legal action, and there's not going to be criminals trying to kill me on the street. Yes, please. I'll do this. Thank you. And so that's how I knew Susan from way back. And yeah.
When did she pick you because of your political theater? I was reading Power Plays.
Oh, my goodness me.
And so I was reading about your plays. Uh-huh. And,
in America?
I got it from Amazon. Yeah.
All right.
When I heard that you were going to do a chat, I looked on IMDb and researched, and I was reading Power Plays.
Wow.
Yeah. And Hillary Glow is the author, but the way she was writing about you, you just sounded so perfect for this show. Background in the plays that you've done, and the fact that Noni did Navigating, that would be cool. There's a line in the intro where she says, in this time of political tension, she's quoting David Hare, I believe, in this time of political tension and in the context of dramatically dichotomous political views, theater seemed extraordinarily important. Well, that sounds exactly like what this show is doing right now.
Well, that's right. And, you know, I know we've talked about, you know, the Jewish aspect of the show, obviously the homosexuality, you know, those issues, very important. And, you know, I became very interested in the communism, you know, the anti-communism of the period, you know, which obviously that, you know, Regina uses against Sarah. None of these things have gone away.
Right, and you touched on the Aboriginal topic, which now you're going to bring back in season five, and you did. I heard that. Is that right? You're going to have an Aboriginal character, perhaps. Which play was that?
Wonderland. I had written a play, Wonderland. Yes.
Yeah, right. Wonderland. Yes.
I reckon you've done so much and read so much that it's all really useful.
Oh, okay.
I think it's age more than intelligence and interest. Anyway, but I appreciate what you're saying. No, I do believe, there's no point in writing unless it has some political use, I believe. Yeah.
Catherine, I just have to tell you that you have inspired me because I just started a new novel and it's set in the 50s.
Oh, excellent. Oh, that's cool.
In America. In America, during the height of the McCarthy years.
The height of the McCarthy period, yeah. I have been writing a film for 100 years that's set in the 30s, which begins, you know, that's really the beginning of McCarthy.
Yeah, the communists, that's when the Communist Party
grew
in this country.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. And it certainly wasn't illegal to be a communist. But,
no, it was cool.
Yeah, and the fear that we won't get into politics, but it's an interesting and relevant topic to even be considering socialism at this time.
Yes, it is.
Catherine, what are you reading?
You know, normally if someone asks me that, because I read on Kindle, and you know how you don't see the cover until you finish the book again. But luckily for me, I can see the cover of what I have just been reading. And it's called, it was a book called The Sympathizer by Viet Thanh Nguyen. And it's set post, right at the end of the Vietnam War. about a double agent who is evacuated, who is Viet Cong, a double agent in the South, and is evacuated to America. Yeah. So,
Don, any last questions?
Surprise.
So,
and I'm currently reading, sorry, I just add, I'm reading, Bevan and I are reading, not together, reading the Riviera set, which is a history of Maxine Elliott and a house in the Riviera in the 90s, starting in about pre-World War One, heading through to the 50s.
Wow. Hmm.
Donna, you got a last question for Catherine?
So I hear or see echoes of Daniel DeRonda and Howard's End in A Place to Call Home. Have those novels ever been mentioned by Bevan in your discussions with him?
I don't recall. I don't know that. I don't. I'm not as well read as Bevan. No, he talks about Trollope a fair bit. Look, I'll write that down. Howard's End. I read Howard's End years ago. No, look, not. But you know, I will be surprised if all of those are running around Bevan's head at any given time.
Catherine, we don't want any spoilers because we don't want anything ruined for us. But can you, before we let you go, can you just give us just a little sense of the mood, perhaps, that we might see in season 5?
You know, I'm not kidding you, but because we just still have scripts on paper, you know, and we don't really, well, now I am fibbing. Yeah, look, we do have a strong sense of the mood of the series, but I really can't give that away without telling more. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Well,
What did Bevan say?
I don't want to. I'm going to paraphrase, but he did tell me that it would be the most Jewish season, and he said that it would be a very emotional, season.
I think that's what's really driving us at the moment. It's driven by emotion. And that is the that's where we're at the moment. We're molding the scripts to make sure that we're turning the gas up when it's needed. And you know, you're talking. I'm sorry, I've forgotten your name, but you know, you're talking before about when there's in pace. You know, so making sure that the emotional drive is there when we need it, and then letting people down gently and then turning it up again. Yep. So driven by emotion, I think is a good way to put it.
I have a very quick question before you go. Who does your research? Both the, not just costumes, but the times and the culture and even the politics of the time.
It had been me. This year, for series 5, I had an assistant, who was typing, who was the note taker in the meetings. And when we had some time, I'd quickly throw things at him. So we began with a good bank of research, not just off the internet, obviously. And we've got the Sydney Morning Herald archives, which are terrific. So, when you're an episode, and I try to get in the habit, I've forgotten. But, if you just go to the paper on that day and you start to feel like you're back in that time, it's interesting. So we do that. And the writers do their own and come racing, and are excited by things. Yep. So we all, it's a mixture. There's nothing terribly set in stone, and it's all kept on Dropbox, and everyone has access to it. But one interesting example was in series 4 when Sarah's having the baby, and I began because it was my episode, and I needed someone who remembered the practices of childbirth. Well, there aren't too many people who remember who doctors, you know, because they would be now 50, 60, you know, they'd be in their 70s, you know, there aren't a lot around. So we did find a midwife who had known someone who could tell us those things. So a particular kind of onset research. And for that episode, I sat down on the set during all of the birth just to make sure, just in case there was something that, you know, needed adjusting really quickly. So I just sat outside the labor ward.
Catherine, one last question for you. You know, a place to call home, while it might be called an Australian drama, it has captured the imagination of people all over the world. There are people watching it all over America, all over Europe, you know, in countries I never heard of. What do you think is so universal about this program?
Yeah, it's a bit of, it's a surprise, isn't it? And it's a delicious surprise. I think the period in which it's set, just in terms of the period as a character, is a time of great change. We're on the cusp of class, of people, even though in Australia, you know, you hear people say it's a classless society, we know that's not true. So class is very important, and that's a universally understood concept, and it creates tension and it creates drama. How are people going to overcome their class? I mean, you mentioned Harry, perfect example, but Sarah and the Blys themselves, their obstacles are universal, I think. A family eroding, you know, in the early series, you know, the son who's homosexual, who's, you know, likely to drag the entire family into the, you know, into the gutter, and all of, I think the personal stories are well calibrated, and they're surprising. So unlike a soap opera where you can usually say the lines out loud, you know, or often can, with this there's always, and this is Bevan's skill again, and Bevan's skill and the writer's skills, is that there are twists. There are interesting twists. I think when you talked about Olivia earlier, not where you expected her to go, yeah? But true to the period, for instance, giving up your child, I mean, we talked about that a lot, that in that time women gave up their children if they wanted to go off. That's how it worked. So finding things that are true to the time, that are surprising, I think all of that is, I hope, contributes to something that people can relate to. I don't know. What does everyone else think?
I think what you say is true. I think because of the issues, homosexuality, anti-Semitism, classism, for veterans, I think it touches on, it takes place in the 50s, but it touches on issues that are very much a part of day-to-day living now. And I think it challenges us to, you know, look at ourselves, look at where we come from, and to, it just challenges us to look at ourselves. Some of the conversations on in our group, where I remember when we started the group a year and a half ago, and there were people who said they, you know, didn't really know any Jews or people who'd been through the Holocaust. And then there were parents who were coming forward and told us about, I've never told this story before, but I have a gay son, and, you know, sharing their stories. And, you know, the veterans, although it's kind of been a small part it touched people tremendously. So I think it shows that how far we've come, but that we really haven't come that far at all.
Well, I mean, I think the core to it really is, you know, it goes back to the title, doesn't it? What does it mean to be home? Is it home in your heart? Is it a physical place? God knows the full of people at the moment who don't have one. I think that's important too, is when will these characters know that they've come home, if you like. Now, hopefully not for a very long time, because that's the role of a dramatist, to stop them from getting what they want. That's our job, is to keep putting up the roadblocks. But that quest to find a sense of personal peace and love, I think, is within all those characters. Hopefully the journey will be a very long one. Or I don't mean long, I mean the gulf between what they want and how they... and the journey they're going to take to be a nice, wide, and difficult one. I think that should be universal.
To pick up on something Susan said, I think perhaps because we all recognize that we're living now in a time of tremendous change and transition, that to look back at a time of transition when you can see, because we're looking back at it, you can see that things changed and changed dramatically, and the world didn't fall apart. It gives you a little more confidence about what you're living through now. To your point on how do you know when you're home, I thought that something I learned just a couple of weeks ago when the Israelis announced the fourth season, I saw the ad on the Facebook page, and they didn't translate "a place to call home" in a very literal sense. They translated it, and someone who understood the program, I think, translated it as the place that can go into your heart. And the word for place that is used is also the word, has these connotations of being sacred. It's another word sometimes that's a substitute for God in Hebrew. So it's got multiple meanings in the Hebrew text that I think really gets out the richness and the layers of the program itself.
Yes. No, that's interesting. Yeah. Well, hopefully those things are what appeals to people. Yeah. I think you're right about that sense of coping with change. There is something reassuring that if their world won't fall apart, perhaps ours won't either.
Catherine, look back at the homosexual issue and I think say, oh my God, you know, at that point it was illegal. James could have been jailed as other people were. People are beaten up. How wrong, but also how dumb it was. There's nothing to be afraid of.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And that you get that, as you say, from that historical perspective. How dumb it was.
Catherine, I want to thank you so, so much for taking time. You've given us some
thank you.
Real insight. I think that when David posts this conversation on the page, that there'll be lots of comments, and you've given us some real insight into how it all comes together. But, sharing yourself with us, I think we have a better understanding of how it all who these people are, and now that we know a bit more about who creates this, it's going to be great for everyone.
Well, so, and can I just stress, the team effort that goes on, nothing is an accident, as you know from Women He's Undressed Now, that my documentary, wardrobe, costume department, will come rushing out and say, look at this dress I've just found for Regina, you know, look at this dress. And so you immediately go, oh my God, that's inspiring me to write the next draft of the script. You know, there's a lovely symbiosis that goes on in the production that, so while we've highlighted the script writing section today, which often gets neglected, we mustn't acknowledge everyone else. Otherwise, they'll kill me.
Oh, but we talked so much about the clothes, and you should know that there are women all over Australia who are now dressing in clothes from the 50s as a result of, and they're not just, they're wearing them in their everyday life, and they're having meetings, and they're coming to brunch, and they're planning a big dinner dance where everybody is, you know, they have their own page where they talk about the fashion that they're going to wear to this dinner dance. So, and we talk at length about the music and the cars, and so, you know.
Right, okay, that's good.
Okay. We're real fans. We're real fans. Again, I want to thank you, Catherine.
Well, very much. That was really, really, really enjoyable. And I hope I painted the picture that you were after.
And after season 5, we'll ask you to come back.
Okay.
Okay.
Could I just say something before we go?
Please.
Yeah. Just to explain that I know that conflict is the essence of drama, and I probably didn't explain myself terribly well before, but I think just my feeling in season 3 was that there was a lot of things going wrong and not a lot of things going right. Not a lot of nice things to be happy about. I just wanted to feel a bit happy and uplifted some of the time, more than I did.
I wrote that down actually, because I'm going to think about that, because I did understand what you mean, but it's good to clarify. No, you're right, absolutely, and who knows? Yeah. Anyway, that was series 3.
And I know that we need the conflict in it, and it's part of it.
But no, I take your point on that, It can often happen that you can start to neglect that kind of those elements. So yes, all right.
It had a bit of a change of direction because of you know, the people being going on to Foxtel. Bevan leaving, I wasn't surprised, but I was just a bit disappointed.
Yeah, but you've seen series 4.
Oh yeah. We're still going. It's just that I wasn't happy with season 3, and because of it was a bit depressing. About what happened.
All right. But have you watched all season 4, or have you had all these?
I've watched every episode ever.
Oh, good. Okay, I didn't want to spoil everything.
No.
And do you think that there were more happier, like, did characters get their happier moments in season 4?
I think that there was not so many terrible things that happened to the ones that we love and care about.
Right. Okay.
I suppose one of the things, if I could go back to Olivia for a minute, is that I didn't like the artist. I was very glad we got rid of him. Very happy. So now we've got Sir Richard to get rid of. He's a good one to keep going, I'm sure, for drama's sake. But
exactly.
If she had fallen in love with somebody. If she, you know, she was a person who was vulnerable and needing somebody to love. And if she had found somebody who was worthy of her love, I would have been happy. But I didn't like him. I thought he was a creep. And I wasn't the only one. Anyway, I better not hold us up any longer. Thank you very much.
Catherine, one more point before we say goodbye.
Thank you.
We love the secondary characters. I don't want to say secondary, but the ones who are, we love Roy Briggs. We love Doris Collins. We miss the Paletti family and the Goldberg family. And, you know, I understand, you know, Bevan, you know, explained to us about, first of all, budget. But we so appreciate how much they contribute to the overall essence of the program, and we certainly hope to see and get to know a little. I'd like to know a little bit more about Doris. Maybe, you know, I understand that she's, you know, has her role to play, but I would just like to know just a little bit more about her and a little bit more about Roy. But they're all spectacular. Okay. And on behalf of the almost 1,500 members of our group, I want to thank you for not just spending time with us, but for delivering so much joy and excitement to all of us.
Oh, well, thank you. No, it really, it inspires us, honestly. And when I was first told about this group, I don't think I had ever worked on a show that had such a fan base like this, so I felt very chuffed, and even more so now to have been invited along. So thank you, and wherever you are, have a nice evening. It must be late, you guys, so sleep well.
Okay. You too. Bye-bye. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye. Bye. I'll just turn. Oh.
All right. Thank you, Susan.